Next, I'll explain the troubleshooting lab for HCIA WLAN. First, let's look at the topology diagram we use in troubleshooting. This is a typical side-mounted networking setup. On the left is an AC controller with a router above it. In the middle are two switches. One is the core switch, and the other is the aggregation switch. Below the aggregation switch, SW2, there are two APs, AP1 and AP2. Users can log into our network from the APs below. Now, let's physically troubleshoot using the actual equipment. First, let's consider the troubleshooting approach. Typically, the problems we encounter can be divided into issues with APs failing to come online and issues with user terminals failing to come online. First, let's look at the situation where APs fail to come online. We should first check the status of the AP. Using the command display app all, we can see the status of the APs. Now, we can see that we have two APs. One AP has been assigned an AP ID, while the other AP is visible only by its MAC address and model. The latter AP's status is unauthenticated, meaning this AP needs to be authenticated first before it can join our network. Let's first address this issue. Enter the WLAN configuration mode, AP confirm. Then we can input an IP to authenticate the AP using IP. Now let's check the status of the AP again. We find that this AP has now been authenticated, and it has been assigned AP ID 1, but the group is incorrect. Our AP should be placed in AP group 1. Now let's change the group of this AP. AP ID 1. Enter this AP. We can set this AP as named AP2 and then inquire further. Now, let's change the group. We can directly paste the group from above. Press Y to confirm. This way, our AP enters the correct group. Let's take a look. Now, AP2 has entered the correct group and has the correct naming. Now, its status is idle. In this case, if AP2 does not obtain an IP address for a long time, it indicates that there may be an issue with network connectivity or a problem with the DHCP configuration. We'll check this issue later. Now, let's look at the issue with AP1. The status is erroneous. Let's find out why it is erroneous. We'll check if AP1 has been placed on the blacklist. We can compare the IP addresses on the blacklist and use the command line to remove AP1 from the blacklist, paste the same way. We'll wait a moment to see if the status changes. While waiting, we can continue to check the network connectivity to see if there are any configuration errors. At present, our AP still has not obtained an IP address. First, let's check the DHCP configuration. We can see our VLAN IF10, 11, 12, 13, all have DHCP configurations set up. We can notice here, interface VLAN IF801 is in shutdown state. Let's see what the role of VLAN IF801 is. Through specific queries, we find out that VLAN 801 is the source of the CAPWAP channel. So, if this channel is shut down, the AC cannot manage the AP, hence we need to open this channel. We need to enter VLAN IF801 and use the command undo shutdown. Now the channel has been opened. After waiting for a short while, we can see that AP2 has now obtained an IP. AP2 is now functioning normally, but AP1 is still in a fault state. Let's continue to check the configuration. We can log into S2 to check the configurations on S2, which is our aggregation switch. Let's first look at the hardware connections using display LLDP to check. AP1 is connected to GE001. Let's look at the configuration of this port. We can see that this port allows VLAN 10 to VLAN 13. Now let's look at the configuration of the port for AP2. We can compare the normal AP2 with the abnormal AP1. The differences between these two ports. The port GE001 is missing a port trunc PVID VLAN 10 command, which is used to set the default VLAN, because DHCP packets cannot be tagged with a VLAN. Thus, we need to set a default VLAN so that packets passing through this port will be tagged with a specific VLAN label, and port GE001 has not been configured this way. Let's now add this command. Command added, now we can see both APs are operating normally. So now the issues with our APs have been resolved. Let's summarize now. Regarding APs failing to come online. First, we need to check the AP's status. If the AP is in a fault or unauthenticated state, which means it is unauthenticated, we can check the blacklist or verify if the AP is not authenticated. If these settings are correct, we can proceed to check if the AP has been assigned an IP address. If not, we can check the DHCP server. If there's no issue with the DHCP server, then we need to check the network connectivity. These are the scenarios when an AP cannot come online in our regular configurations. We'll definitely encounter more situations than this. So during troubleshooting, we can trace the problems in our devices based on the diagram. Next, let's look at the scenarios where the STA fails to come online. Firstly, if we want our terminals to come online, they must be set to automatically obtain an IP address. If our terminals have been manually assigned an IP address, and possibly an incorrect one at that, then definitely the terminals will not be able to come online. Therefore, we need to change our address acquisition mode to automatic. If, after the change, the IP address is still not obtained, we can then check the configuration on the device. Here, let me give you an example. Our devices have a blacklist. Taking our topology as an example, if our STA cannot come online, we can check the VAP profile we are using. For instance, this voice one, which allows us to display many parameters. And within these parameters, we can see this line, STA access mode is blacklist, which means a blacklist. We use blacklist template number 1, so we can check whether the terminal is on the blacklist. Let's look at this blacklist template. In blacklist profile 1, we have a STA MAC address, followed by a MAC address. So what does this command mean? It means that devices with this MAC address cannot come online, cannot connect to our WLAN network. So we can remove this MAC address, allowing the device to come online normally. Because there is only one MAC address, we can choose undo STA MAC all. Now it's gone, thus we've removed the address from the blacklist, and our device can now come online. If after this operation, users still cannot come online, or if the user's network is very slow, then we can further check our channel utilization, as well as the packet queues on the Wi-Fi driver side, and issues in CAPWAP or other network segments involved. This way, we can resolve the issues of STA failing to come online. That concludes our lesson for today. The basics of troubleshooting. In fact, when it comes to troubleshooting, the most effective method is still our thorough understanding of the principles of our equipment, and being very proficient with its configuration. In this way, once we see a particular phenomenon in a device, we can immediately think of the corresponding configuration and the likely problematic nodes. So I hope everyone will practice more after this. Thank you all.